Hello students, welcome back. Today I am Anuradha from DPS Haldwani Lamachar, going to start another topic of the same chapter which we are discussing in the last class, and here we are taking the revision session. So in this revision session we were talking about the microsporogenesis. Okay, what we were studying about the microsporogenesis, and what we studied here that microspore relate to what? The microspore, it means that it is a pollen grains, and genesis means to create something or to form something. So here we are discussing about the formation of pollen grains. Okay, and as we know that we were discussing about the sexual reproduction in flowering plants. Okay, so what are the flowering plants? We know that angiosperms are the flowering plants. Okay, and wherever there is a flower, there will be a reproduction. And what type of reproduction? Sexual reproduction, in which we will get the male gamete as well as the female gamete. So from where it will come? Okay, when we have to go for the sexual production, what is the requirement? Male gamete as well as the female gamete. So there must be a male flower as well as female flower. Okay, which they will produce. It may be male flower or female flower, or sometimes it may happen that both of the things present in the same flower. Okay, in which condition? In the monoecious condition, right? So here what I want to say that first of all there is a requirement of male gamete. So how the male gamete will form? With the help of the male gametophyte. Okay, so what is the male gametophyte? We know that pollen grain. Okay, so this pollen grain will form where? In the flower. If I will draw this flower here, as we have discussed in the earlier class also, that it is what? It is a thalamus. Okay, so in this thalamus, what is present here? This, what is this? This is the ovary. Okay, and we know that ovary having three different parts, that is stigma, style and ovary. Okay, stigma, style and ovary. From here we know that some sepals are also present which are green in color. Okay, so these are the sepals, and along with the sepals we are having the petals also. Okay, we are having the petals also. This is known as what? This is known as the corolla, and these sepals are known as the calyx. Okay, so if I am talking about the monoecious flower, it means that both male and female gametophyte present in the same flower. And this is what? This is the female gametophyte. Along with this, we are talking about this male gametophyte which is arising from here. Okay, and we have done in the structure of male gametophyte that these are what? These are the anthers. These are what? These are the anthers which are bilobed structure and connected with the help of filament. Here also we are having anthers, then stalk is known as filament, and again they are connected with the thalamus. One more question, how they are connected? Okay, we have done that there are two ends, proximal end as well as the distal end. Proximal is near and distal is far away from the thalamus. Okay, so these filaments are attached with the thalamus with the help of the proximal end of the filament, right? So this is about what? Male gametophyte. So now we were discussing about these male gametophyte. Okay, how the male gamete will form? So if you will take this male part from here, okay, so what you will take? You will take this anther and you will take the cross section of this anther. Okay, when you will take the cross section of these anthers, what you will get here? You will get these bilobed structure. Okay, so this is the simpler form of the anther, right? So anther having the two lobe. Okay, in each lobe it is divided into two thecals. That's why we said these are the dithecals. So here what is happening? They are the dithecals, right? And with the help of connective they are attached with each other. Okay, so in each of the theca you will get the pollen sac. Okay, what you will get here? Pollen sac, and inside this pollen sac there will be formation of pollen grains, and when they will go outside, what they will form? They will release the pollen grains and it will reach into the female flower. Okay, or we can say female gametophyte, and attached to the stigma. Okay, now here we have done that what is the process. Now we have to understand that how it is forming. We said that it will start from where? It will start from the archisporial cell. When it will start from the mass of undifferentiated cells. For example, these are the mass of undifferentiated cells. And this stage is known as what? You will say that it will undergo division. Okay. So, we will start from where? From the archisporial cell. What is the meaning of archisporial cell? It means that it is a primitive cell which is present here in the anthers. Right? So, where it is present? It is present here in the anthers. Okay? Now, there is a requirement that it should undergo division. Okay? When it will undergo division, so what type of division is required? There may be requirement of the meiosis. Why? Because we know that any of the plant cell, it is what? It is diploid in number. What it is? It is diploid in number. It means that it is 2n. So, for the gamete formation, what is the requirement? It should be haploid in all number. Then only what will happen? One male gamete and one female gamete. Okay? And there will be fusion of and formation of diploid zygote. Right? So, for forming the diploid zygote, what is the requirement? That gamete should be haploid condition. Okay? Now, these archisporial cells or the cells which is present already here in the plant, it will be the diploid number, and we said it is a archi means something old or the primitive cell. And this time, what is happening, you can see that what you are seeing that there is a no differentiation of layers, no differentiation of nothing, right? So, when it will undergo the meiosis, what it will form? It will form the haploid, and these haploids are known as what? Microspores. So, directly it will not form the microspore. In between, there are some different stages. So, what are the different stages here? These are the archisporial cell, as I have said. Now, there may be two type of division. What are they? Division can be of two types. What are they? Periclinal division and another one is the anticlinal division. Now, what is the meaning of periclinal division? Whenever the division takes place or happening at the layers. For example, this is one of the cell. Now, what do you understand by the periclinal division? It means that when it will divide like this and it will form the two layers. From one layer, it is forming the two layer. What type of division? Periclinal division, right? Another division is anticlinal. It means that just at 90 degree, when the division will take place like this, at the 90 degree angle, okay, from every side. So, here what is happening? The number of cells is also increasing. From the above division, we understood that there will be increase of layers. Okay, here what is happening? Just at 90 degree angle, so what it is increasing? It is increasing the number of cells also. Okay, and this is our objective. We have to increase the number of cells. Okay, and when it will undergo the differentiation? What is the differentiation? When they will undergo the proper distinct layer of each pollen grain. Okay, not the pollen grain exactly, about the anthers. Right here. So, here what we can see that these archisporial cell undergo first of all under which of the division? Periclinal division. What will happen? Periclinal division. Right? When it will undergo periclinal division, it will form two layers. Right? Here I have just shown you the help of one cell because inside this archisporial cell, so many cells are there. Okay? So, we have taken from here this cell. So, it means that whatever changes is going to happen, it will be inside this cell only. Okay. So, like this, there are so many cells inside this one and every cell undergo the division. Okay. Periclinally as well as the anticlinally. Okay. So, now first of all, it will undergo the periclinal division and it will divide into two different layers. What are they? Primary parietal layer and the primary sporogenous layer. Okay. What is primary parietal? It means that parietal means that which are present at the outer end. Okay. And what is the primary sporogenous cell? Which is present at the center. Okay. Now, if I will show you the exact structure of this, we can say anther. Okay. So, what you can see, that as it is a bilobed structure, it is having different layer. Okay, again I'm drawing it here. It will show the different layer. What are the different layers? The outer layer. Okay, this outer layer having cell, which is known as what? Epidermis. Right? What is there? Epidermis. Inner to it, there are some more layers. Whenever I will show the cell, I will show with the help of these type of structure. So what are they? Epidermis. Okay, and due to this periclinal division, what will happen? It will differentiate it into the epidermis as well as below the epidermis. Right? Now again it will undergo division like this. It will undergo division and division. And what it will form? It will form some other layer, that you can say what we have said, epidermis, then endothecium. Inner to that, another layer is there. Okay, another layer is there of cell. This is known as the endothecium. And inner to that, there is a middle layer. So how many layer we have drawn? In simpler, I am drawing the outer one is epidermis, then this one endothecium, this one middle layer. Okay, inner to this middle layer, you are having another layer that is known as a tapetum. Okay, this one is tapetum, and inside this tapetum, pollen grains are present. Okay, so like this, in your book, you can see this type of diagram as well as this type of diagram. I have drawn both the diagram in the same anther. Okay, so what you can see here, when there is a periclinal division, it has formed the outer one. Peri means at the peripheral end. Okay, when the peripheral division, it has differentiated into epidermis, endothecium, then middle layer, then tapetum. Okay, now this tapetum will provide the nutrition to the pollen grains which are developing inside this pollen sac. Okay, so what we are calling this one? Microsporangium. What you will call this pollen sac? Microsporangium. Okay, microspore, it means that sporangium which is holding the pollen grains or the microspores, these are the microsporangium. If I will talk about so many microsporangium, so what I will use a term? Microsporangia. Microsporangium means so many pollen sac, and microsporangium one pollen sac. Right here, so what we have discussed, that after this division, it has divided into different layers, and the outer layer, it is known as the primary parietal cells. What are they? Outer one, primary parietal cell, and the another inner one, or we can say at the center. At the center, what you are having? Primary sporogenous cell. Okay, and what is the requirement? Now we want this sporogenous cell, because parietal cell are important for what? For making the layers. These layers are functioning as a protective nature, as well as when this microsporangium will get matured. Okay, so they will get outside, or the pollen grains which are present inside this microsporangium, it will go outside. For going outside, what is the requirement? There should be dehiscence. What is the required? There is a requirement of dehiscence. It means that time it needs that these layers should be ruptured. Okay, if there should be no rupturing, what will happen? Pollen grains will not be able to go outside. So these are helpful for the dehiscence of anthers. Okay, these are the two functions of these layers, and tapetum, we know that nourishment of the pollen grains. So we have done the primary parietal cell and the primary sporogenous cell. Now what will happen in this primary sporogenous cell, which is present at the center? Okay, which is present at the center, it will again undergo division. Okay, when it will undergo division, mitotically what will happen? They will form four haploid spores. Okay, what we are getting after the whole meiosis? Four haploid spores. Right, first of all, from 2N we are getting, okay, how many? Two haploids. Okay, if these haploids again will undergo division, so we know that another division is just like mitotic division. Why? Because what is happening in this case? The ploidy level will remain same, only the number is getting increased. So here what we are getting? N and 4N. Four haploid spores, and these haploid spores are going to form the pollen grains. Okay, so now we have to understand that what is happening in this primary sporogenous cell. Okay, so here we will understand that how there is a formation of sporogenous cell, and we know that outer structure we have done, inner structure inside this microsporangium, what you are getting? Inside this microsporangium, you are getting the pollen grains, and these pollen grains, okay, these pollen grains having the different shape. What is the different shape? That outer structure is what? It is known as the exine. Okay, outer structure is known as the exine, which is due to what? Due to the presence of the sporopollenin. There is one term, sporopollenin. This one is very, very important. Why? Because due to this, the presence of the sporopollenin, the microspore or the pollen grains are getting thicker in structure. Okay, and due to this, we can preserve it as a fossils. Okay, so we can preserve the pollen grains for a longer period of time due to the presence of this sporopollenin. We can say the viability of pollen grains is very long. Okay, so here you can see that the whole exine is present, and this inner part, this inner continuous part, it is known as the entine, right? So outer one exine and inner one which is smooth, that is known as entine. And there is one space, okay, some more spaces may be there, where this exine is absent, okay. There, what will happen, where exine is absent, what you can see, there is a germ pore. What you will call the structure? Germ pore. Why this germ pore is important? Because if there will be sporopollenin or the exine, the pollen grains which is present inside this one, it would not be able to penetrate the germ tube. Okay, so to forming this germ tube, what is required? It is the requirement that there should be no exine at that place. Okay, so for forming this germ tube, there is a one structure that is known as the germ pore. Okay, so this is the structure of what? Pollen grains. Now, what is happening here in this pollen grains? How it will rupture and how it will go outside after the dehiscence? We have to understand that one. So here what will happen, this pollen grains again divide itself. Okay, this pollen grains will divide itself, and what it will form? It will form two cells. What are they? Vegetative cell and the generative cell. What you will call it? Vegetative cell and generative cell, like this. Okay, now this pollen grain is divided into two parts. It is having two nucleus also. Two cells, two nucleus. What is the definition of cell? Every cell which is having the nucleus, it is only a cell. So it has formed its own nucleus, and here also one nucleus. So I'm showing with some slightest smaller structure that you can differentiate it very easily. So what is happening? The bigger one is known as what? Vegetative cell. The bigger one, it is known as vegetative cell, and the smaller one, it is known as the generative cell. Okay, now see, two condition may be there. Here two condition may be there. What will happen? This is known as what? Two cell stage. Okay, sometimes it happens that it again forms the three cell stage. What is three cell stage? In which two cell are present like this. Okay, two nucleus is there. This generative part again divides mitotically, and it form three cell stage. Okay, so this is a two cell stage, and this one is the three cell stage. Okay, and generally if I will talk about the microspores, they are in what structure? They are in structure of this one, this structure. It means that four microspores are forming, three are, you can see from here, and one from the backwards, right here. So what you are getting here, that three or the tetraspore. Okay, we can say tetrasporangiate, it is a structure of the microspores. Now, why I have drawn these two types of structure? First, we will understand that what is vegetative cell and what is generative cell. Okay, now, vegetative cell, as I have said, I have drawn here that you can see this is larger as compared to the generative cell. Okay, the first thing, it is larger, as well as generative cell is smaller in size. Then I will talk about the vacuolated cytoplasm. Okay, if I will talk about this vegetative cell, you can see that so many parts accommodate with the vacuole here. Okay, so the cytoplasm of this vegetative cell is what? It is vacuolated. As well as if I will talk about the generative cell, because structure is small, so what will happen? Everything is present very densely. So the cytoplasm of this generative cell, it is the dense one. Okay, so clear from here. Now another point, the nucleus is large in case of vegetative cell, while in case of this generative cell you can see that the nuclei is prominent, okay, as compared to the vegetative cell. And what is the requirement here? Again, the generative cell, because this generative cell will form the germ tube. Okay, so germ tube will form from which cell? From the generative cell. So here what is happening, that it divides mitotically to form two non-motile gametes. Okay, so we are talking about what? We are talking about the generative cell. So this generative cell, I'm talking about this smaller part, will again divide mitotically and would form the two non-motile gametes. From here what will happen? It will form, for example, it is a generative cell, it is having N. So from this N, what is going to happen? It will form two another haploids. Okay, so this process is known as microgametogenesis. Micro relates to what? The microspores, and gameto means gamete formation. Okay, so what type of gamete formation is going to take place here? The microgametes. Okay, now the question arises that how these anthers are going to dehiscence. Okay, so it may be two cases. What are the two cases? That two cell stage and the three cell stage. So already I have discussed that what is two cell stage and what is three cell stage. Okay, so for this we should know that 60% of the angiosperms, it means that majority of the flowering plants, they shed at the two cell stage. Okay, it means that, for example, it is a female gametophyte. Okay, if any of the pollen grain will reach in this female gametophyte, so this is present in which condition? Two cell stage or in the three cell stage? So here I'm going to explain that how they will form the two cell stage and how they are forming the three cell stage. So here the pollen grains shed at two cell stage means that when it will come here, before that what will happen? It will form two cell. Okay, now in second condition what you are seeing, that 14, it means that in the lesser number of angiosperms you can see that generative cell, this generative cells again divide mitotically. Okay, here again it divide mitotically, where before the dehiscence, it means that before the dehiscence or before this shedding of pollen grains, first of all it will divide itself mitotically. When it will divide itself mitotically, what will happen? Mitotic means that to retain the equational division, whatever the ploidy level is present here, it will remain same. It means that from this haploid, it again form two haploids. So now how it will look like? It will look like three cell stage. Okay, so we can say that in the 40% of the angiosperm, this generative cell first of all undergoes the mitotic division, and due to this it will form two cell, and you can see that it will form the three cell stage. And after this, after forming this three cell stage, it will dehiscence from the anther and it will reach to the female gametophyte, that is the stigma. Okay, now another condition, in the earlier condition what we have discussed, that already when it will reach here, when it will reach in the stigma of the female gametophyte, then here this generative will cell and it will send two nuclei, or we can say with the help of the pollen tube, it will send two nuclei inside this pollen tube and it will reach into the ovary of the female gametophyte. Right, so two things are very important. So here we have completed are the mechanism of the pollen grains, how it is reaching from the male gametophyte to the female gametophyte. Now what is the significance of this pollen grains? The first significance is that the sexual production. If there will be no formation of pollen grains, no sexual reproduction will take place here. Second thing, sometimes we are using these microspore or the pollen grains for the nutritional value. Okay, because it contains very high amount of this nutritious value. That's why nowadays we can see that supplements are present in the market and they are going very good. Okay, so these are the importance of pollen grains. Now, in the next lecture, we will understand that what is a megasporogenesis. In very short, I'm just explaining you a megasporogenesis. What? Nothing. We are discussing about the female flower. Okay, we are not discussing about the male. Here we will discuss about the female gametophyte, which will consist of three parts: stigma, style, and ovary. Right. So here, that's all for today. Thank you.